Hello, everyone, and welcome along to another Toon Under podcast. Another victory Monday for us, I think. So that's something to celebrate. Now, I apologize in advance if my internet flakes out. I'm new house, new internet. First time on here with this, so let's see if it happens. I'm sure the lads will keep things going if I break up and disappear for a bit. Craig, you look like you're still above water for the moment. How's everything up there in Mackay?
I've got the snorkel ready. I've got the sandbags at the ready as well. It's been raining for about 4.5 days solid here. Parts of the area surrounding me are cut off because of floods, but so far we're so good. Hopefully it stays that way. Fingers crossed.
It's just mental. It's like Craig's in flood zone. Bobby is down in fire territory because there's like bushfires and everything down in Victoria, despite them having floods like a month ago. So yeah, welcome to Australia, guys. Lee in Brizzy with me. We're actually doing okay. Touch wood. We've not got too much going on with the weather at the moment.
It's been all right, hasn't it? Last week before that, has been pretty chummy. Now it's been sort of mid-30s, low to mid-30s. Kind of complain about that. Bit shit today, like, but, you know, the excellent result this morning kind of got me through the day. I'm absolutely knackered, by the way. Newsflash, Lee is knackered. But it was a midnight kickoff, so I didn't get to bed till like 2:30. And the Ben's not well, so I didn't have a lot of sleep. Hopefully I'll soldier on, you know, I'll soldier on here.
We'll get through. It's always easier coping with the lack of sleep when there's a win to talk about, let alone sort of a win in the circumstances that it came in, shall we say. So let's sort of not waste any more time. We'll crack into the game. So we'll go through the team sheets quickly. Newcastle team, for those on the audio, Nick Pope in goal, Tripp, Sven Botman and Dan Byrne at the back, Bruno and Longstaff and Willick in midfield, with Miggy, Joe Linton and Wilson up front. Pretty much unchanged from the Leicester game, I believe. Craig, what did you make of that? Did you expect any changes, or are you happy just to kind of go in with that team lineup?
Didn't expect Joe Linton to start because of the obvious. But Eddie said he had a chat with his coaching team and he thought it was the right call to make, and whatever Eddie's happy with, I'm happy with. But that was the only one that potentially, I think, we were all expecting a change to happen. But yeah, good, strong starting 11.
Yeah, it's been doing a business all season.
Yeah, I think, hasn't it? I think, I mean, we've all kind of got to the point now where we understand Eddie's not going to change sides just for the sake of it. If a side wins and wins comfortably as we did, you've got to think that he's going to keep faith with them. Joe Linton obviously was the elephant in the room that needed to be addressed, and everyone was expecting him to be dropped. So I had my own feelings, and I think Lee was fully expecting him to. And obviously, I mean, none of us condone drink driving, so... I mean, the guy, silly lad, basically, but it was an internal matter. He's going to get a fine or a driving suspension or whatever. The authorities are going to deal with it. Lee, I mean, my feeling was, I don't like the fact that we are seen to be able to be dictated to by everyone, because we've got to kind of keep this squeaky clean persona because of our sort of PIF and Saudi links now. But do you think that it would probably have been a good move to give Joe Linton a game out?
Well, I mean, in an ideal world, I would have said yes. And that my expectation was that Big Joe wasn't going to start this game. And I didn't think it would make sense for him to be on the bench either. If you follow the logic of punishing him by not playing him, then, you know, you don't even stick him on the bench, do you? I wasn't quite expecting Joe to be playing. I mean, the Saudi thing and the PIF thing that you mentioned, that's kind of completely irrelevant. This is a domestic kind of legal issue. For in the UK, obviously not allowed to drive drunk, as you're not allowed to do pretty much anywhere else. It was really early in the morning as well, which is kind of really curious as to what the hell he was doing out there after 1 a.m. when you presume at least that he's going to have training the very same day, essentially. Very unusual. I mean,
I think they had that day off. I think they had the next day off or something, so that it wasn't a training day, right? I believe.
Oh, I see. Right. Well, I mean, we only have the kind of headline. We don't have any of the deals behind what you know, anything else about the situation. And then perhaps Eddie has a little bit more information, having spoken to Joe Linton directly, perhaps. But I mean, just because these guys are role models, and you know, there should be consequences for idiotic stuff like that. I think it would have been the right decision not to play him. Now, obviously, how we actually would deal with him not in the team would have been a bit of a conundrum. And I mean, Joe Linton was superb through this whole game. So, you know, I think it had a direct impact on us getting something out of this game. I think it might have went in a different direction had we not played him. And maybe that's why Eddie Howe put him in.
Yeah, look, I mean, he's been absolutely imperious for us of late. So I totally get why Eddie Howe wants him in the side. I think we all wanted him in the side, but they're, you know, sort of actions have consequences. And it does sort of need addressing, I guess, which I think it has been. Now, look, I mean, my last take on the Joe Linton thing is, we don't know, as you said, we don't know any of the details. We don't know whether or not he's been at a party, he's had a couple of drinks, he's waited around till one in the morning thinking, I'll be fine now. And then he's gone and he's blown a little bit over the limit, or he's had two beers and he's just blown over the limit. Everyone's kind of taking this as like, he was mortal and he couldn't walk straight, let alone drive a car. And, you know, the truth is none of us know that. He was over the limit. He's being punished for it. You know, Eddie Howe's dealt with it. I'm sure he's dealt with it internally. I'm sure he's dealt with Joe Linton and had a chat to him about it. And he's kind of like, yeah, as you said, he's a role model at the club. So, you know, you want to have like those sorts of players setting the example for the kids out there and all that sort of stuff, and just generally not being dickheads. And it is a bit of a dickhead move, let's be honest, but you know, let's deal with it. Move on. The bench for me, you know, it's great to see Isak back. Lewis, Richie, St. Maximin, Lascelles, Dubravka, Mankio, Wood, and Murphy. Doesn't have starting at a little bit of depth there, but it's more kind of like workhorse depth, if you like, where, you know, apart from St. Maximin and Isak, we haven't really got a great deal to come off the bench in terms of quality. So would you agree with that, Lee?
Oh, I mean, it's gonna be the theme for the rest of this season, I think. We can't build out this team in the space of, you know, two or three windows, whatever it's been to this point. Yes, the window is open right now. We haven't really done any business apart from Granski. That was done even before the World Cup, I think. So, you know, watch this space, what happens for the next 2 weeks or so. But you're not going to be signing. You're not going to do a Nottingham Forest. You're not going to go and sign another, you know, seven or eight bloody players. I mean, first of all, you've got to have a squad. You've got to name that squad. And secondly, obviously, we all know there are certain constraints that we have to try and work within, not just now, but with an eye on the future as well, in future windows. And I think that's the delicate balance they're trying to strike with the amount of money that we might spend in each window, including this one. The depth itself, I mean, I'm still surprised Bravka's there. I have no idea what the hell happened to Karius. He's presumably left. I mean, I've got no idea what happened to him. You've got Lascelles, who doesn't get a game these days. ASM, who has a point to prove. Yeah, I mean, you know, Richie, Lewis, they're kind of in Manquillo. They're just there making up numbers pretty much. Isak, obviously, is the big dog. Chris Wood can do a job now and again. And then you've got Murphy, who lacks sometimes, but he isn't shy of putting a shift in. As you say, a workhorse kind of guy. So there is definitely space in that squad to improve Newcastle's depth, and I'm sure will over the next couple of windows, probably.
Oh, for sure, Craig. I mean, like, there's talk of Lascelles, someone putting a bid in for him. I think it was Wolves, if they didn't get their preferred target. You've got to think Richie's looking for a club, much like Fraser. You know, Lewis, I don't think he's really going to get to the level where we hoped he would. You know, Mankio, probably going to be out the door if we can get another young right back to kind of understudy to Trips. So yeah, what do you make of the squad in terms of that depth piece? Because this is something that is going to be a massive issue for us to secure that European spot, given that, you know, like, well, we're out of the FA Cup now, so that's one less sort of distraction for us. We've got potentially three games left in the League Cup now. So it's just purely concentrating on the league, but fixtures are going to come thick and fast after the cup final. Hopefully, fingers crossed that we get there. What do you make of it, and what do you think probably needs to be addressed first?
The midfield, absolutely. We've got no central midfielders in that subs bench. Yes, we've got the option of bringing Big Joe from the wing into the middle. But now with Bruno's injury, and hopefully he's not out for as long as people may be talking about on social media, that is a massive cause of concern with Shelby being out for the foreseeable future too. That's two very experienced key players not in the team for however long that may be. Central midfield needs to be addressed. And I think what happened with Bruno may have just accelerated those plans as well.
Yeah, we'll definitely come to that.
News comes out, we don't know exactly how long he's going to be out for. Hopefully it's just a matter of a few days. But Newcastle be Newcastle. It could be however long it wants to be. And it'll probably be months from now, unfortunately.
Yeah, fingers crossed on that one for sure. So let's have a quick check over the Fulham lineup. Leno in goal, Tete, Diop, Ream, and Kurzawa, Palinha, Reed, Andreas, Dikodova, Reed, Mitrovic, and Willian. Obviously, the big talking point for any Newcastle fan with his goal scoring record in the Championship. And he's sort of banged a few in the Premiership. Is Mitrovic up top? He seems to have really matured as a player. Kind of maybe needed that little bit of drop down in level just to kind of get settled, make sure he was in the lineup that he felt more comfortable in. And people have been sort of saying, "Oh, we shouldn't have sold him. We shouldn't have sold him." Personally, I don't think he would actually fit into the style of play that we are doing right now anyway. Even with his new persona and his newfound maturity, shall we say. But, you know, look, he's obviously doing the job for Fulham. They love him. He still has respect for the club that he left here. It sounds like he still kind of has a soft spot for Newcastle. Craig, like, what did you make of that team? Where do you see the main threats coming from on that? And obviously, without getting into the details of the match with the penalty incident, how good do you think Mitrovic is? Or is it literally just that they've tailored everything around him?
Yeah, he's their number one target man, isn't he? He was effectively our Callum Wilson. For the start of the season, he banged in quite a few goals, quick succession. He scored on the opening day of the season, which is always a good way to get off the mark. Gives you confidence from day one. And he hasn't scored in a few games, I think, now. I may be wrong. I know he missed one with a suspension or injury too. So maybe that's playing on the back of his mind now. Yeah. He is a quality player. Whether he's quality enough to come back into our squad and add something to it, probably not. But he is definitely a player that is, as you said, matured over the past 2-3 years. He needed that time where he just out of the Premier League, out of the limelight, and he's settled down in Fulham now. And hopefully he can make something of it and get Fulham maybe into Europe, because they're on a decent run of form themselves.
Yeah, I mean, he was young when he first came to Newcastle, and it's probably one of those things where, you know, it was probably the right club, but at the wrong time for him. We've seen a few over the years, no more than John Dal Thomason, I think, was the classic example where, you know, he went on, left us, went on to have a really good career at AC Milan, but just too much asked of him, too young, I think, at the club under the pressures here. So, Lee, your thoughts on the team before we head into the game?
Yeah, look, I mean, I'm one of those kind of people who doesn't really watch other teams all that much, so I don't have a really close opinion on this before the game, that is. I mean, obviously Leno's a good keeper, Mitrovic, as you've said, and Willian. I've always liked Willian. I think he's a pretty handy player when he's on form. And I remember from the last time we played Fulham down there, when we won 4-1, that when I was reading the forums afterwards, which I always do, a great deal of the commentary was from the fans there was that Palinha was a ginormous miss that day. And I think he was pretty effective in this game as well. Mitrovic, for me, is a confidence player. I did like him when he first joined us just because he was an absolute nut job. I've still got that image in my head of when he picked up Rafa, like he was one of those inflatable party balloons. Like, you know, it was just,
yeah,
unbelievable.
That
unbelievable
was even going to core strength.
Yeah, man, it was like unbelievable core strength. It was just like to lift up Rafa. Pretty impressive quads and stuff there, but no, he's, I think for me, he's a confidence player, as Mitro, and Every time it seems that he's in the big league, he starts with a bang, and then around about Christmas time, he just fades away, and he doesn't really add much more to his goal tally. It might be the same thing happening now, since we're at the halfway point, and it's kind of on par for that. His confidence is a little bit down, and you missed last game on suspension there, Craig. So that's, if anything, that should have given him an extra bit of time to recover and get his fitness ready for this one, because the rest of the team pretty much played on Thursday, and I think you could see they were sort of shagged a bit during the later stages of this game, the latter stages. Mitrovic, however, was just not in this game at all. And how he sorts his head out after what happens, we'll talk about later on. Will be interesting to see. But I've got a feeling that his confidence is a bit low. And it'll be interesting to see what does the rest of the season. I would not be surprised if he doesn't have very much to his goal tally at all.
Yeah, we'll get to the issues surrounding Mitro. Look, I've always liked him. I thought he was, he always had that little sort of renegade rogue element to him. He's always a little bit sort of bit of a screw loose, proper Raj now and again. But yeah, wasn't to be. He's definitely not a Rafa style player, so it was never going to work out.
Newcastle fan as well. Which goes far. You know, Murphy's a Newcastle fan. He's not from Newcastle, but you know, and that's
his parents are.
Yeah,
so
yeah,
he
yeah.
was but he I mean, was born down south, but his parents are from Newcastle.
That's what I'm saying. So Murphy's not from here, but he's a Newcastle supporter. Mitrovic obviously is from Serbia. He's a Newcastle supporter. Alan Shearer, the influencer everyone seems to cite. You know, it's just it's one of those things. Like you say, wrong club, right club at the wrong time.
Yeah. So on to the game, as you just touched on, Fulham played on Thursday game. So they basically had 2-day turnaround before they played us on the Sunday, and it was an early kickoff on the Sunday as well. I know that Marco Silva was going a little bit off his nut in the papers before the game, saying it wasn't fair and we had the advantage. So, you know, it was kind of like laying the excuses down already, if you ask me. But you know, let's get into the game and we'll sort of go through. So, you know, look, Fulham for the first sort of 10-15 minutes or so, it was a pretty even game, and Fulham started to actually really get into the game a little bit, I thought. They had a couple of sloppy passes that back from Botman. Few bits and pieces that just didn't go our way. Gave the ball away. We kind of got the ball back again. Fulham had a few forays forward without really creating much at all. And then probably the thing that no Newcastle player really wants to see is we had a challenge where Bruno goes down, rolls his ankle when he was challenging Paulina. Now, it didn't look like there's a lot in the actual challenge itself. I mean, it was literally just he's landed awkwardly. He's gone off balance. Having done my ankle myself, I think it is something that I winced at when I first saw. And then when you saw the replays of it coming back in, and he fairly went over on it. He was in a lot of pain, had it all sort of like strapped up during the game at various bits and times during the first half. Obviously, that's a huge thing for us. He was hobbling around for the rest of that half. Still played surprisingly well, considering he was almost on one leg by that point. Lee, did you think it was going to be a bad one when he first did it, or did you hope it was just going to be, he's tweaked it a bit, like, let's just run it off and see how it goes at halftime?
Well, I'm not a medical expert. I mean, if you watch someone go over on their ankle, it looks absolutely ridiculous. Like your ankle and your foot's not meant to be at like a right angle to the rest of your leg, sort of thing. I think we've all probably at some point kind of went a little bit over ankles, and it kind of gives that kind of massive body shock. It's like, holy shit, that was sharp, horrible pain. And more if it's just a simple thing, it'll usually just go away. But he obviously was in some kind of pain. Credit to him for trying to get through the half, and he did manage to get through the half. In hindsight, Eddie said that perhaps that was not the best thing to do, but he always goes by what the player thinks. They know their body better than him, especially when they're out there on the pitch. So you have to kind of give it to Bruno for wanting to get through it. The problem was for me was that he'd made that lovely through ball to Longhi just earlier on in the first sort of 10 minutes or something. Absolutely beautiful kind of through ball, which Longhi kind of then Newcastle falconed off the top of the Leasers roof, killed a few pigeons. But it was a sensational ball. And for me, even by that point, and actually even halfway through the rest of this first half here, he was still everywhere. He was coming deep. He was going out wide. He was slotting the ball to the sides, through the middle. He's just that kind of influential person that when I saw him struggling towards the end of the half, I was actually really concerned like what we were going to do for the second half. The obvious thing to do was bring Joe Linton in and bring on ASM. But for me, you're taking out the central cog of that team, the one that makes everything tick. And so, yeah, I mean, I was absolutely concerned when he didn't come back out. It was no surprise. I mean, I think we all probably thought there's no chance he's coming back on. I think he gave the sub signal, didn't he?
Just before half time. The thing is, I mean, he left the pitch in tears. He knew it was a serious thing, and just the drive and the will to play by the lad. He wants to play. He doesn't want to miss games. He wants to be involved all the time. He's got immense leadership on the pitch as well, which you kind of don't really think about, but he does lead by example on that pitch. And he kind of almost had more of the ball after the injury than he'd had before it. Everything's just seemed to kind of like grow, like sort of focus in on him. He seemed like a magnet for the ball after he'd injured his ankle, which I was kind of like a little bit concerned about, sort of stepping away and trying to kind of just take a little bit more gentle. He was still getting stuck in and chasing stuff down. So Craig, not a great spectacle for Newcastle fans to see someone like Bruno, as influential as he is, to come off the pitch the way he did.
Lost you there, Mark. Nope, all good. But yeah, my take on the whole Bruno thing, I think crazy unlucky. Okay, there's obviously malicious in there.
Locked up, I've locked up, or Craig's locked up.
Or anything. It was an absolute shame, but the fact that he's injured is now just going to be a test of what we're actually made from. We have played without him for a few games already this season. That was during in and around the Liverpool game, I believe it was. So we can play well without him, and we proved that in the second half. But he, as you mentioned, Lee, is the big cog to that machine in the midfield. So it will be a massive loss, but again, it'll be a test of our mettle. And I still think it's going to accelerate plans in this transfer window. Wonder if Mark's going to join us again.
Yeah, the reason why Bruno was getting the ball a lot, though, was simply because he's so good at finding those little pockets of space to receive it. And he wants the ball all the time. He's constantly wanting the ball. He wants to receive the ball. He makes things happen. And that's why he was getting a lot of the ball. But, I mean, that's par for the course with Bruno, man. He's just unbelievable.
Mm-hmm. It was a shame to end the half on effectively a sour note. But Eddie made the correct changes, and I think the team that came out in the second half had a strict game plan and they stuck to it. And we started that second half pretty solid, I thought.
Yeah, considering Mitro was pretty isolated in the first half. It was very, very good defending on him. They covered him well. To come out, I think, you know, having had the chances we did, I mean, we had a few half chances, you know, Longstaff skying the ball and, you know, Wilson's spin and shot that from, I think it was Fabian Scharpass. That was gorgeous as well. You know, on another day, we kind of go in halftime there 2-0 up. And I don't think that's sort of hyperbole. I think we probably were good for at least a one or a two goal lead, given the chances and the domination in possession. And it was always one of those things where as soon as you kind of go into halftime nils apiece without having capitalized on your dominance in the game, there's always that thing of like, yeah, they're going to come out and they're going to score and we're going to have to like be really up against it. But in fairness, we came out and we played really well in the second half as well. Fulham had their moments again as well, but you know, look, we came out with ASM replacing Bruno. Joe Linton looked like he dropped back into midfield a little bit. Look, I mean, I don't know. We'll go through the halftime stats, I guess. So half time, 57% possession. Probably doesn't reflect the dominance I think we had in the first half. Like shots 11 to 2, four shots on target to nil. You know, we had dominance in that game. Fulham had a couple of spells of possession, but you know, Lee, that dominance there, you would think we should be scoring a goal from.
Well, of course, I mean, that's, you know, four shots on target, 11 shots in total isn't a bad set of results for the first half. It just shows you kind of how in control Newcastle were of this tie. I'm the same as you. I'm surprised Fulham got anywhere near 43% at halftime. It didn't feel like that at all. But if you think about some of those shots, you know, Wilson was being really a bit of a handful. He was receiving the ball well. He was finding nice space. He was doing some nice little trickery. I get the impression some people think Wilson isn't firing on all cylinders, but for me, that was one of these best games in a while. I mean, I know he's been injured, but I thought the very fact that he's wanting the ball and he's finding the target most of the time, and yes, not scoring, but I mean, you need your striker to be in the right positions to get the ball in the first place and get a shot away. And I thought Wilson did very well. And yeah, I mean, at halftime, 0-0, I'm not really sitting there thinking, oh, it's going to be one of those games. I could see enough from the likes of Wilson and the opportunities he was having and the good positions we were finding ourselves in to feel like we would get it there in the end. I didn't stay that way, mind you. I was starting to crap myself when I was getting towards the end of the game, especially when a certain someone got a penalty. Yeah, I mean, I think I was fairly comfortable at halftime, if not a little bit disappointed we hadn't scored, yeah.
Yeah, the crowd was a bit flat. I know you noted that. It seemed that they needed a spark. Craig, did you kind of like feel that the crowd was kind of almost, well, we've done our part now, like you guys need to give us something back? And it kind of does feel that way at times with the home crowd.
Yeah, absolutely. It was hit and miss from the crowd today. They started off well with the war flags display as they normally do. But it's ups and downs and fits and starts with the crowd. There's nothing really consistent from it like it used to be during maybe the Rob Snow Keegan years, where it was raucous from the first whistle to the last. And it is as if we need maybe a hefty tackle, a good shot, a sting in the keeper's hands, or just a good bit of play just to get the crowd back onto a volume where it can be heard over the commentators, you know. But they definitely do play the part. They are the 12th man, as Eddie keeps saying. And there was points where the crowd was on form and they were as loud as they have been all season. I think that was maybe just after the penalty, to be honest. Because stuff like that does give the crowd a lift, which is quite strange. But it also gives the players a lift too. But yeah, crowd very hit and miss today. And hopefully we can get our singing voice back for the next few games because... Again, they are a very, very powerful part of that stadium.
Yeah, for sure. When it's rocking, it's like nothing else on the planet. You know, we kind of had there was some half chances and there was a bit of scrappy play. I mean, we had a few random challenges here and there. Then the thing that really sparked the crowd up happened around 60 odd minutes, 63 minutes, I think it was, according to Lee's notes that I'm reading off now and again. there was all sorts of stuff going on in the box. What I saw was Dan Byrne potentially pull a Fulham player that went down in the box, which got waved away. The play carried on. The Fulham players were enraged. The manager was enraged. The crowd were like moaning at the Fulham players. And then all of a sudden the play stops and we end up going back for a VAR review on something completely different that I'm not sure anyone really saw the first time around, which was apparently Kieran Trippier having a mistimed challenge on one of the Fulham players, which on replay was kind of a bit dubious to say the least. On further replay, which apparently the ref was never shown, it shows the Fulham player stamping on Trippier's foot first. So it should have been a Newcastle free kick. So anyway, the long and the short of it is Fulham got the penalty. Up steps Mitrovic. Very typically, yeah, I was thinking to myself, here we go, X player, he's going to ruin our day. We've had so much possession. They're going to score from the spot, and then it's going to be like they're going to sit back and defend for the last sort of 20-odd minutes of the game. This is not what we wanted. And then Mitrovic manages somehow to double hit the ball on the way. Now, whether or not there was some conjecture whether or not one of the Newcastle players had scuffed the spot. Nick Pope was a little bit cheeky as well, a bit of shithousery, having two balls on the pitch and wouldn't throw the other ball off and tried to give it to a Fulham player and dropped it. And it was all a little bit sort of... a little bit of mind games, a little bit childish at times, but you know, these things amuse me at times, especially at like 1:30 in the morning. But you know, look, the first instinct I had was this is going to get retaken because of encroachment or because something. There was obviously some sort of incident had happened, and then the ref like blows the penalty away, says it's a free kick to Newcastle. Now, I think all the commentary was actually saying this is the actual rule. It's like he has actually double hit it, but you can't do that. As soon as you hit it from the spot, someone else has got to take it. And I think they brought that rule in because people were trying to do double tap penalties and weird stuff like that. Craig, what did you make of the incident and how pleased were you to see that that free kick was given our way?
Well, first of all, I don't think it should have been a penalty. I thought the one with Dan Burn, maybe, was more of a penalty than the one that was awarded. I think the reason why Dan Burn wasn't is for how soft the player went down. I think he ever stayed on his feet, maybe just slowed up, pulled up, that type of thing. Penalty might have been awarded then. And maybe Dan Burn could have been red carded for that because he was the last man back. But getting on to the penalty itself, I called it straight away as soon as it left his foot. As you see him slip and... the angle that I seen, the ball was going to his left or Pope's right, but obviously it then goes to the opposite direction. And Pope, literally the second he hits the floor from going to dive to the direction the ball should be going originally, he's up in, he's in the ref's face saying there's been a double hit or whatever it's going to be here. How Pope managed to see that in real time and dive and get up and make that claim straight away is baffling. I know it's a goalkeeper and that's his job to keep track of the ball and everything like that, but that was just, it was almost instinct for how quickly he noticed that straight away. I thought it was absolutely fantastic. Now, he was going to dive the right way, so maybe he would have saved it anyway. We won't know. But it was genuinely hilarious. Mitrovic running away, celebrating. He knew from the second he's touched that ball that he's fouled it. And he was just waiting for the ref to blow the whistle. I think he might be the third person, an ex-Newcastle player who has missed a penalty against us at St. James's. Yohan Cabaye is another one in his Crystal Palace days when Carl Darlow saved it. I don't remember that one. And I think Loic Remy when he was at Chelsea as well. Okay. I think he missed a penalty against us too. So maybe there's a bit of a hoodoo going on there that ex-players can't score penalties against us and long may continue.
Well, he became the first player since the 2018-2019 season to miss three penalties in a Premier League season. It was, I think Pogba and Sigurdsson both missed three penalties in that season. He's actually also failed to score in any of his last four appearances for Fulham against Newcastle. So, you know, Lee, you had the conspiracy theory that he meant it and he didn't want to score against Newcastle.
100%. 100%, mate. He couldn't bear to score against his beloved Newcastle United. No, I mean, I say that in jest, obviously, although I'm not entirely sure if I'm joking about that or not. But the reason why he balls it up is because I was reading on the forums that every time he does penalties, and he's missed quite a few, I think he's missed 3 and 6, what he does is he plants his left foot down and then swings in his right boot to take the kick. At times you'll slip, at times you'll kind of not get the contact right. On this occasion, he slipped as he's planted his left foot. It's presumably went a little bit too far forward. That's why his right foot, when he's kicked the ball, has actually clipped his left foot. It didn't have to clip it very much either. And the reason why Pope knows what happened there is because Pope knew exactly where that ball was going. As you said, Craig, he's diving in the right direction. If it ricochets somehow and goes in the other direction where he can clearly see which way it's going, it's obvious something's not quite right. And in any event, any reason to swarm the referee and, you know, get up in the referee shit and say, like, you know, ORF, blah, 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 this and blah, 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 that. They're going to do it. Yeah, he did it on purpose.
Cracking finish, wasn't it?
It was cracking finish.
But you can tell when he peeled away, he wasn't celebrating very hard. He knew it had hit his other foot, so he knew.
Pope knew straight away. Yeah, Pope was straight up and straight at the ref, which I have to say, like, just a quick note on that. One of the things that we were saying early in the season and certainly late last season was how nice the players are and how much they were just sort of letting things go and, you know, whatever happens, happens, and we'll take it and we'll be nice about it. They're starting to get arsey with it now. They're starting to get, like, aggressively challenging decisions that don't go their way. They're starting to really get in players' faces. They're starting to get in the referee's face. And I don't normally like that sort of stuff, but when everyone else is doing it and you're seeing the results go their way, it's really nice to see that we're starting to get that little bit of a chip on our shoulder and you know, wanting those things to go our way and trying our best to force them. It is a nice little thing to see the evolution of that attitude of the team and the players as a whole. That's something that I'm actually sort of watching carefully to see. I don't want us to get to the Man United levels where we're kind of entitled and, you know, the ball goes out of someone's backside and it's like, no, we want a penalty. It's like, yeah. And especially after the offside call on the Saturday night, which was absolutely disgraceful, that knocked us down to fourth position as Man United won against Man City in the Manchester Derby. Yeah. But anyway, and I'll not go on about that. Fergie time is still happening, apparently.
Yeah, apparently. But look, just coming back to that penalty, I mean, just before that penalty happened, we'd struck the post from Shaw, I think it was, from a free kick. I think that was beforehand. Mm-hmm. We were all over Fulham. They were hacking us down at every opportunity. Every time we tried to do a breakaway, they were bringing us down and getting yellow cards. And even before that, it was visibly obvious to me because I made a note of it around about 50 minutes. They were wasting time at every opportunity, especially the keeper. And I'm not complaining about it because that's what we do literally all the time. It comes back to what you've just said there, Mark. But on the penalty itself, Byrne got lucky a little bit, I think. But when the ball is kind of recycled and comes around the second time, Willock gets hacked from behind as he's trying to bring the ball away. Nobody seems to want to mention that. He was actually sideswiped from the behind by one of the Fulham players. He goes down, Fulham win the ball back. And then, as you say, Trippier is stamped on, quite clearly stamped on. And I was watching one of the reviews of the game. I can't remember who it was. It might have been Match of the Day. Yeah, it was Match of the Day, I think. Match of the Day 2. And they made the point that if you look closely at the referee when he goes to the sideline to watch the VAR camera, on the TV, the one view that he needed to see Trippier getting stamped on before he kicks the other guy, flicks up on the screen as he's already turned his head away because he's already made his mind up on the previous views that didn't show that very clearly, and he's off giving it a penalty. So, the whole thing was just a mess from start to finish. I think Byrne got lucky. I think, you know, on another day.
That's a good segue into, like, my VAR rant. So we've had this conversation on our group chat today, where is VAR actually adding to the game or is it taking away? And I said my views were, I don't think VAR is working as intended. I think it's taking more away from the game in terms of the immediate fan reaction. And, you know, you score a goal now and you're sitting back going, well, is it going to be given? Are they going to review it? Who's been offside? And they're still getting decisions wrong. Like, yes, okay, we're getting some of the decisions overturned and rightly so. We're getting some decisions either given or overturned that are still wrong, and we're still going on about it. So is it at the point where, you know, as Lee, you said today, you know, it's here to stay. It's not going anywhere. Do we need to dial it back and stop ruining the moment for fans while we fine tune what's happening with it? So keep it in for, like, goal line technology. Like, for me, that's the ideal thing. Like, does the ball cross the line? Yes or no? It's a binary answer. There's no interpretation to it. Offside stuff, I'm kind of all right with that. But when it comes down to, well, we're still asking the referee to interpret what we're seeing and we've kind of not giving him all the views, and we're, you know, it's like the Willock push earlier in the season. You know, we scored a goal that's ruled out. We can't celebrate that because we don't know what's going on, or we do celebrate and then they overturn it. And it was wrongly overturned because they didn't give the ref all of the angles that were available. And then we all see the extra angles on TV and you're thinking, well, hang on a bit. So, Lee, like, I mean, go.
It's not going to go away. It's going to stay here. It was always going to be one of those things where they bring it in a particular form. Bearing in mind, they can't possibly think of every single situation or scenario that's going to crop up. They would have brought that in knowing that it's going to have to get refined from season to season to season. That's a process that's continuing to go on. It might be a process that never really ends. What I would like to see is, I would like to see it being more consistently applied across every ground that uses it. I think it needs to be calibrated with cameras that are in set positions. I mean, for God's sake, Wolves getting an apology from the league when they were denied that goal, they didn't rule out the Liverpool goal or something that happened. And the reason they gave was because the ITV cameras, the bloody TV cameras, the guy controlling it zoomed in too fast and they couldn't work out what was going on. I mean, it's such a ridiculous thing to be coming out with, when it's a key component of how the game plays now and how the game is officiated. That, to me, it needs to be properly calibrated. You need to have cameras down every particular area that makes sense with cover, if at all possible. And it needs to have some serious training for the people in the box, for the people in the nest who control this thing. They need to have some serious training. I think I heard a rumor or statement that AI might be coming in to try and clean up some of that particular issue. And obviously that will probably just introduce other issues that we'll have to then deal with.
We already use AI offside in the Champions League.
Right. Oh, so that's probably giving you an idea of, to some extent, in certain circumstances, where they're going to take this VR thing if it works out to be a goer. Things like not showing the right or the complete picture when the ref goes to the sideline, it's not good enough. It has to be consistent. It has to be all the angles, or you just don't do it at all. But why? Mm-hmm. Because what you've got there is you've probably got some kind of inherent bias in the people who are controlling what the referee sees. It's humans. It's people with their own desires, own thoughts, own ideas. You can train as much as you like, but sometimes these things surface, subconsciously sometimes. And it has to be, a solution has to be found where it's consistent and it's calibrated. And then I think we'll find out that there'll be far fewer instances like this. But it's not going to go anywhere. I don't believe it'll go anywhere. I don't think I want to go back either. I don't want to see people shithousing and getting away with it because there's no cameras there to tell the ref that the shithouse, do you know?
For me, there's two things wrong with VR right now, and one is the camera angle thing. I think the people in the studio or wherever, the truck where they're doing all this thing, they need to go to the ref, say, look, we've got four different camera angles of the same incident. We're going to show you one after the other. And once you've seen all four, make your decision based on that. Simple as that. And the other thing is, when the ref, you'll watch the same bit of footage 32 times over and it's taken 5 minutes to make a decision. That's too long. The game's dead. The momentum's gone. There should be a timer, which if you can't make that decision within, say, a 30-second, 45-second time frame, the original decision stands. That's how it should be. It really boils my piss when the ref is just standing there watching again and again and again and again. Move on with it. Get it done. You can't make a decision. Continue with the original.
Yeah, the whole clear and obvious thing that kind of got thrown out the window because it didn't suit certain clubs or something. But anyway, it's not going to go away. It is something. It's just we kind of moved on from, oh, that ref decision was really crap, to, oh, that VAR decision was really crap now. And we've as Craig says, we're losing momentum in games with no real end in sight for, we still get to talk in the pubs about bad calls and bad decisions, which VAR was meant to kind of take away. But we've lost things that don't seem to have brought equal things back again, equal sort of opportunities to get that sort of stuff sorted out. But look, it is that consistency thing, as Lee said.
And just one more thing. Sorry, Mark. It would be nice to hear what the refs and the VAR are saying about these sort of things. It happens in every other bloody sport that has cameras. We've already established that games will stop now because of VAR. So the whole thing about keep the game going isn't a thing anymore. If it ever was, Christ, I mean, you know, teams have been wasting time and kick the ball out and all kind of shit since it started. Why can't we hear what has been said for something that is such a critical decision? I mean, I think in general, you should be able to hear what the ref's saying anyway, because it gives an insight into exactly what's going on and removes a lot of the speculation aspect of it. But I mean, particularly when the game's stopped, and VAR and the ref are consulting about something, why the hell can't we hear that? Why is it so secretive? What are they worried about? What's going to happen if we can hear what the VAR guy is saying to the ref and what the ref's thinking? The ref could just sort of say, all right, well, looking at that angle there, I can see that dude has been clearly infringed, blah, blah, blah. I'm going to give a penalty. Off he goes, gives a penalty. Everyone gets to hear it, or at least people at home anyway, because, I mean, that's where most of the speculation starts. And you know, hopefully the whole process.
There's nothing to stop it being done on the pitch as well. I mean, you look at the NFL, that every time there's a decision, the refs basically turn their mic on, they say it gets broadcast around the stadium. Yeah, yeah. And so all fans that are at the ground still get to know exactly what's being called and what was happening.
Yep.
There's no excuse for it in today's technology age. You can do that sort of stuff. I do agree with that. Yeah. Anyway, back to the game. So we've basically sort of had a slice of luck. We still keep our momentum up. We still press them. Obviously, Fulham starts kind of like time-wasting a little bit, I felt as well. But, you know, we get Big Dog comes on. Strangely enough, though, for Willock, I would have expected either Wilson to come off or maybe him to come on for, you know, someone else. But, you know, Willock was doing quite well. So he comes on and almost sits into that number 10 position in behind Callum Wilson. And I thought, well, let's see how that works, because that meant, and as Lee's kind of got in his notes as well, which I thought was really interesting, is we had ASM, we had Joe Linton, we had Miggy, we had Isak and Wilson all on the pitch at the same time. Now, if we can add Bruno back into that and get everyone firing, that's starting to look like a pretty scary first 11.
Got another verse to the song, haven't we? but I think it's the first time even Isak and Wilson just them two. That's the first time they've played together. I'm the same as you. When Willock went off, I thought that was really harsh. I mean, yes, you can say that he doesn't have the end product and blah blah blah, but he puts in such a bloody shift for this team, as does Longy. And up to this point, and this was around about the 75th minute or something. Wilson has just huffed and puffed and hasn't really done a great deal, and he's still coming back from injury. So you think the most obvious thing to do is to like for like it, you know? But Eddie had different ideas, and thank Christ he did. That's why we sit here and he sits over there.
Yeah, indeed. That's why he earns the big bucks. 89 minutes. Just an insane bit of dogged determination from Callum Wilson. Shoots the ball, the defender gets in the way. He's the first to react, basically just dinks it across. Isak sitting there unmarked in the box, easy header in, 1-0 up. Isak sort of runs away, sort of celebrates with the crowd, celebrates with Wilson, celebrates with the rest of the team, and rightly so. That is now 3 goals in 4 games for Isak since he came here. The mind boggles. If he'd been fit for the entire time that he's been here, because I think he would be pushing up there in terms of reputation for goal scorer in the league at the moment. I know a lot of the hype's been surrounding Nunez and Haaland, and you know, Jesus at Arsenal as well has been on fire. So it's kind of nice that we've got our potential, you know, big name striker. You know, he's looking the part. He's making some really good runs. He's had a couple of times where I've noticed he's tried to dribble past players and just like ran straight into them. And I think that's just a part of, he needs to get used to the league, and it's not the slow leagues that maybe he has played in. He needs to get used to the pace of the game, needs to get back into form in the league as well. I mean, the fact that he's come back off an injury for he's been out for so long, he's obviously going to be rusty, but he's still scoring goals. So, you know, that's the mark of a really good striker. So when he gets fully up to speed, yeah, watch out, I guess. Craig, what did you make of the goal and how pleased are you that Isak's back on the score sheet?
Big dog does it for again, doesn't he? And he should have 4 and 4 goals, by the way, because that one at Liverpool should have counted.
That's true.
Definitely nothing wrong. Again, another VR issue with that one, but again, we'll move on. The manner of the goal was fantastic. Wilson, like, his dog determination, not giving that ball up. And I think the second we knew it left Wilson's boot, it was going in. He had all the time in the world to finish that. He just let it bounce off his head, runs away to Raptors. Gallagher goes mental, as it normally does when the ball hits the back of the net. Players celebrating like they've just won the second leg of the semi-final against Southampton. But that goal, to me, was probably the most important goal we've scored this season because it stopped another run of draws. I know we had a spell back early in the season where we had four or five draws on a row. And I think if we had done that again, maybe players' heads would have dropped. Social media certainly would have been a bit more toxic, saying we've got all these players, why aren't we signing anybody, the window was open, blah, blah, blah. But that was the most important goal we've scored this season, purely the fact that it stopped that potential run of draws again.
It gives that belief to players that, yes, look, we're dominating games and we're not scoring, but at some point it's going to come. It's going to happen. We are going to win those nasty, dirty games that maybe it's not just this free-flowing football, but we're finding a way to win. And I think that was kind of what was missing early on in the season. We just didn't have that extra notch, but you know, we've got players coming in now that affect the game and they're starting to believe they can as well. Lee, obviously you're over the moon that Isak's whoop. Hang on, I think I'm out again.
No, you're still here.
I'm still here.
Yeah. No, look, I mean, just to come back to one of the things you said before there, where he's probably trying a bit too hard, given that he's had this massive signing on fee and he hasn't had the opportunity due to the injury, the very long layoff that he's had, that he hasn't had the opportunity to really show people, you know, why he's worth 60 million and to contribute to the team's performance. Fortunately, we've done pretty well without him. we've opened the top four, but, you know, just in the middle of the pitch, he was trying too hard and he actually lost the ball in the middle at one point and the ball fell kindly and he kind of looped back around before any of the Fulham players could get to it and he spread the ball out wide to ASM. Nice and simple, but it was nice to see he didn't give up on his kind of initial losing of the ball. And that was where ASM ran into the box and was kind of like a notch chuff away from kicking the bottom corner. So, you know, determination throughout this entire team. I think he's probably bought into that from Eddie already, if he didn't already have that as part of his character. Obviously, we do the character assessments before we sign these people, and it's good to see signs of him already potentially looking like he's going to be one of Eddie Howe's kind of players. But I just want to give a shout-out to Wilson, really. He tried all game to get a goal. He tried all kinds of shots. He tried headers. Nothing was going in. He could have done better in pretty much all of them, obviously, because he didn't score any. But some of his touches were sensational, I thought. And let's not also forget Longy, because he's ran the most of anybody in that team in that game, and he still had the strength of legs to whip that absolutely beautiful ball to the far post. But to come back to Wilson, he went to header it. It bounced off the back of Diop, I think it was. And, even at 89 minutes, he's still switched on. He's still alert. He's still looking for opportunities. And big dog, Isak, he's kind of watched this from afar. He's sort of loitering in the middle. And he sees that there's a potential ball to him coming up. And he starts to move into that bit of space. Very clever, very switched on. And, you know, even how Wilson gets that chip across him, because he's still under heavy pressure from the defenders. You know, there's only a small window to cross that ball and not get saved by the keeper or whatever. And he does it with aplomb. And, yeah, of course, Big Dog just knocks it in and off he peels away. So I think there was a good few. And also, don't forget Murphy. He actually blocked their move down the wing in the first place. And spread it to Trips and then it kind of bounced around a little bit. And then that's a crossing from – from Longy. So just the fact that all of these guys are still at it at 89 minutes because they're desperate to keep this top four place. They're desperate to keep this run going. Wins beget wins, you know, confidence begets confidence. And I've said it even this season, we're not the kind of team that breaks down teams that park the bus. Credit to Fulham. I thought they were very, very good today in the sense that they broke up play when they had to, did the dirty stuff, defended really well, but they didn't do a Bournemouth. They didn't just park 11 men behind the ball. They actually did try to play the game at times. Yes, we contained them exceedingly well. But I thought Fulham were very good on the whole. And we've managed to get to the end and get that goal and take the 3 points. And I think if you can win games when it looks like nothing's going to go in for you, if you can still manage to get the points at the end of the day, you're doing something very right, even if it's ugly. If you win ugly, you're still doing something right.
Still 3 points at the end of the day, isn't it?
Still 3 points at the end of the day, but it's the effort. It's the mental fortitude. You know, it's the intent. I think these guys want to go into this League Cup semi-final on the back of an undefeated run. And who knows, they might be able to do it. Because, you know, like I say, confidence begets confidence. We are absolutely flying.
Well, right now, we've literally lost two games all season. The FA Cup game and the Liverpool game that we probably shouldn't have lost anyway. So, you know, you take that into consideration. That is just a monumental effort from everyone concerned at the club.
Yeah. And the FA Cup was like, you know, second string for the most part, apart from the guys we couldn't replace because the squad's not good enough. So, you know, if Eddie had took the decision that the FA Cup was just as valuable as the League Cup the following few days later, you know, we might have got through that game, but who knows what happens in the League Cup? I think he made the right decision at the end of the day.
Yeah, look, I don't think we've got the squad for three of them. I don't think we've got it is because we've got the game off between both League Cup games as well. So we've actually got and I think Southampton will be playing on that weekend. Yeah. So that's a really good lift for us, I think.
And I think that's when Joe goes to in front of the magistrates as well. I think he's in between those two games.
Hopefully, fingers crossed, it's all lining up for us. Look, I want to sort of before we sort of leave the match and start talking about managers, I want to just sort of say I was actually impressed with Maxi when he came on. There's still that little bit of decision making. And one of the big things we've said is like, is he going to fit into Eddie Howe's system? And there's been massive question marks over his attitude and his commitment, his work rate. There were times in that game where he did lose the ball or, you know, somebody didn't sort of put the pass exactly where it needed to be. He worked really hard and I was actually really impressed with him. Like he ran like across the entire pitch to try and close someone down at one point. And I'm like, you know what? You keep doing that and then you've got that extra little something that nobody else can give you in terms of being able to run at players, then, you know, you're going to get back in that squad and you're going to be a valuable member of that squad as well. And I was just pleased to see that those big question marks that I think we've all been discussing in terms of his attitude and his commitment and his work rate more than anything. I think some of those were answered to a certain degree, and it's whether or not he can consistently keep doing those now. It's something that I think was a big tick in the right direction for him, and hopefully he keeps going with that. Wood came on, replaced Wilson. Chris Wood's a good defensive reinforcement when we need to just keep things tight, I think. I think we've established that he's not going to be this fantastic force for goals from open play. But, you know, if he can come on and still do a job for us, then, you know, that still gives a big thank from me. Thank you from me. And, whistle finally blows. 1-0 win to Newcastle United over Fulham and back up into third spot. So can't complain at that. So we'll have a quick check over the stats from the second half. Obviously 1-0. 62% possession to 38% possession. That is kind of getting to the point where it's more like what I was expecting it to be from the first half, to be honest, given our dominance. 20 shots to 5. And I think that sums up why we deserve to win that game. Don't get me wrong, Fulham defended really well. And there were times in that game where we had efforts on goal that we thought we probably should have scored from, but Fulham had some last-ditch defending that blocked a lot of those shots as well. So, you know, credit to them. And it wasn't just that we were missing chances. Some of it was down to Fulham defending well. You know, we've almost doubled their passes. You know, we've got five shots on target. They had no shots on target. So how anyone can turn around and say that Fulham deserved something out of the game and Newcastle didn't deserve to win it is kind of a little bit mind-boggling. So, Craig, you up first. Obviously, huge stat advantage in our favour. How good is it to see that we're starting to kind of pull these wins out when we are this dominant in games?
It's fantastic. And one of the stats I'm going to touch on is the shots on target. Zero for Fulham. Now, they're not the first team that we've played against this season that have had zero shots on target against us. And I know you can go into games and you can defend well, but the keeper pulls off some miraculous saves, that type of thing, and you get clean sheets that way. But we're having clean sheets because that defensive line, that four, is just blocking everything that's coming through. And Nick Pope, we probably could have had a cup of tea on the halfway line if you wanted to, because nothing was getting past them. Now, there's got to be three, four, five games this season where we've stopped any team from having a shot on target. That's got to be some type of a record for us as a club as well, because normally the keeper will be peppered with shots left, right and centre, but we're stopping shots, which is stopping the goals, which is keeping the clean sheets. Is that 11 clean sheets you've had so far this season?
That is 11 clean sheets this season, and we've only conceded 11 goals in the entire season so far.
It is genuinely batshit crazy. It really
that is.
And that stat there, it just nullifies how well we are playing as, again, not just a back line, but as an entire squad. As Eddie says, we defend from the front. And it just goes to show that. And other teams will see that we're not just hard to score against, we're hard to get everybody shot against. Yeah. And that is another real good thing that moving forward is a big positive for us.
And let's not pretend that this is a team that's struggling either. They were closing in on European spots before this game. They were playing really good football. So to keep them to zero shots on target, I think is just tantamount to what a job that this team as a whole, every player's bought into it and every player is performing their duty to the best of their ability. And I think it's everyone's trying to keep hold of their shirt because they all want to keep in that team at the moment.
Yeah. Absolutely. I mean, it's been a meritocracy since Eddie Howe came in. We said last season, like, that shirt, by and large, that shirt is there for you to lose. And yep. And I think it's breeding the correct mentality. But, I mean, the fact that they had no shots on target is probably largely due to the fact that we contained them in the forward two-thirds of the pitch. And when they did break through, obviously, you know, we got lucky with the penalty, I suppose. But we have, usually speaking, the back line to snuff out any danger. Pushing them out wide, for example, is one of our common tricks. Like you said, Mark, I'm not exactly sure why. I mean, there's been plenty of games where we've went somewhere and we've just basically defended for our lives. Fulham didn't have to defend for lives necessarily, but they did have a barrage of shots and they haven't had much in the way of possession compared to what we did. They have tried to play the game, but we've managed very well to contain them well away from our goal, which is a great way of defending, isn't it, really? But why they would take that as a reason to get something out of the game, I mean, some of them were saying they were unlucky not to win, which is a bit surprising. You never know. I mean, if they score that penalty, it's potentially a different game altogether. And, you know, once you're chasing, you open up and you leave space, and we know how that works. They may have an argument for that in the sense that they've put in an absolutely monumental effort, especially given they only played two or three days earlier. And they were on the run of four wins, I think it was, and this was going to be the fifth. And they would have only been a point behind us, I think, if I'm not mistaken, if they had won this game. So, you know, they've got a lot of things going for them right now, Fulham. They did play some nice stuff when they started to string the passes together on the sort of few and far between opportunities that they did that. But I think you have to say that Newcastle were ultimately deserved winners. And I know there are some Fulham supporters out there on the forums who say the same thing as well. So it's not just me saying that. You'd have to say that, really, if you're being
impartial. After missing that penalty, I think any fan base is going to be a little bit up there are sort of a little bit put out by it, because you've got your penalty, you should be winning that, you should be at least be scoring that and then getting in front of the game. So, you know, you're always going to have a little bit of a sour taste in your mouth after sort of missing out on that. Quick look at the table. So back up into third, as I said, that form table, I think, is something to behold. And that is now, we have the longest active unbeaten run in the top five European leagues in Europe football. That is just that's just crazy. Given where we were 12 months ago, that is just such an amazing turnaround in form. And it's nice to see that a lot of the media and a lot of sort of other fans now, I think, are starting to kind of sit up and take notice of us. And we're getting a little bit of credit where they're looking at the likes of Chelsea and how much they're spending, and they're looking at Man United and how much they've spent. And this, Newcastle's just buying their success. And then they're seeing these numbers being thrown at them and that, well, actually we're not. We're just making the best. Yes, we've spent money, but show me a team that's sitting in the top half of the table that hasn't. You know, show me a team that's had any run of success in the last, you know, well, since football began almost, I think, you know, any sustained success, they've spent money to buy better players. It's as simple as that. So, but the point is, I think people are seeing Joe Linton, Miggy, you know, all these players that were there before Eddie Howe took over that were almost out the door. Fabian Schär, another one, that they're all just playing so well, and Eddie Howe's getting so much out of them that it's just like a breath of fresh air. And it's just such a credit to the manager and his staff that he's getting this much out of those players. So, before we finish up, because it is starting a bit late now, and we'll talk about, and we'll get our man of the matches as well. Marco Silva, Raji beyond belief. he got a yellow card. He screamed and he shouted and he went on like, as my dad would say, a two bob watch. He showed himself up on the sidelines, and he's not the first manager to do this. Now we are starting to royally annoy lots and lots of opposition managers and lots of opposition fans. And I'm here for it. I'm loving every single second of it, because we spent so long down in the doldrums under Mike Ashley that we weren't a threat and everyone was happy for us to be in that position. And now all of a sudden we're seen as this threat and teams are losing it at us, and it's absolutely priceless. So, Craig, I'll let you go first, because I know Lee's got something to add to this as well. But, I mean, it's just so good to see us causing problems.
Yeah, as Eddie said, we're not here to make friends or something along those lines. Personally, I think we got to take over.
Craig, did you want to add anything?
I think you've gone, Mark. We're not here to just take part. We are here to take over, personally. And these early signs are absolutely fantastic. Within these 12 months, the transition of the club has just been phenomenal. Nobody said or even thought we would be in this position. And the likes of were seen with Arteta at the Arsenal game. He was going proper Raj on the touchline within the last 20 minutes or so. Conte, he was going a bit crazy as well for the Spurs game. Every single team we come against, where we'd normally be pushed over the side, be pissed on, beaten 5-0, that type of thing, those results aren't happening anymore. And we are seen as a genuine threat to anybody else who wants to make a top four, top six, whatever. Long may it continue. Like I say, we're not here to take part. We are to take over. Newcastle United is back, and I'm fucking loving it.
Look, I just want to say the stat before you read that, because it's just incredible. So apparently yesterday was our fifth league clean sheet in a row, and it's the first time ever in the club's entire history that we've managed to do that. Five clean sheets in a row. First time in its entire existence. That's where this club's going right now. As for the managers, I've got a theory on that, and I think it's basically down to a bit of lack of respect for Newcastle as it stands right now. I was thinking about this today. We aren't seen as a top four, top six team right now. We are probably seen as an intruder into that kind of area. And it's surprising that it actually affects the managers outside of the top six, the traditional top six teams, as much as it does the top six teams themselves. Hello, Jurgen Klopp. I think that's just because we are seen as a plucky, lucky team right now who have got, you know, untold riches, and of course we should be doing well. And maybe there's a little bit of jealousy mixed in there as well, but I suspect it's mostly just down to the fact that we've done that for so long. We shouldn't be where we are. We have no right to win these games, get these points, be where we are. And it's going to take, you know, maybe it'll start happening from next season when we actually start getting that respect that at least I hope we'll earn come the end of this season. And those kind of opinions will change a little bit, perhaps. That's my theory on it anyway.
It could be a bit of jealousy as well thrown in there, that other managers are kind of looking on going, well, Eddie Howe's doing a really good job. He hasn't really spent all that much money, but the potential is there for him to be an unstoppable force if he does end up with more financial backing or they keep improving the squad. It's probably a lot of factors involved. Obviously, Marco Silva's had a bug up his ass because of the two games in 3 days or whatever he had anyway.
It's fair enough. Fair enough, by the way, because that's
which is fair enough.
Yeah, it's a ridiculous schedule.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I think he's already had sort of things in the background going on where, you know, he's had his huff already. And then Newcastle kind of being as dominant as they were, them missing a penalty. I think it's all just been this sort of perfect storm of radginess.
He wanted Burn sent off.
His
primary issue was that, you know, had Burn been sent off, the game changes completely, and of course it does. So he's got a point about that. Whether or not he's right about the fact that he should have been sent off or not is a different matter.
Even if it was a penalty, it was not a sending off offense. It would have been a penalty and a yellow card. Offender, it wasn't like he was the last. Well, was he? He was in the box.
Maybe he was like, last man back. Yeah.
Was he? Okay.
He was.
Okay.
He was. So, which is why he's losing his shit. But it's on the back of the fact that they've got such a good run going, and they just beat Chelsea, and you know they're starting to really kind of bruise a few faces up, just like we are. I mean, they're very similar in some respects to how we're going right now, with where Fulham are right now, and the kind of advances and how they want to play. Because, you know, I think there were a number of similarities in the commitment and the effort. They just came up against a team that happened to be slightly better, you know. But who knows where Fulham will be next season? They're not going to get relegated.
I would love to say, though, that one of the things I love about Eddie Howe is the fact that he doesn't lose his shit. He's always calm, collected, and measured in his responses. And I love that about him, where he doesn't get rattled and he doesn't give anyone easy ammunition to get back at him over it. I mean, we're sitting here talking about Marco Silva or you know, it's there's none of that happens. Even when we have a bad decision go against us, Eddie Howe's always very diplomatic about it. And I think it's probably one of those things where he's unflappable, so it kind of gets under people's skins even more.
Now he does. We have seen him lose his shit a little bit on the touchline, but it normally takes a fair bit of provoking before he starts to think, this has gone too far. Sit your ass down, you whinging shitbag. You know, off the pitch though, he's very composed, very measured, very thoughtful in his responses, quite respectful to the people who ask the fucking most boring, dull questions like, "So, do you think that win was a good 3 points?" Yes. Yes, I think that was a good 3 points. Yes. Great, great question, by the way. Yeah, yeah. You know, he doesn't go like, "No, that's a shit question, piss off." He's good. He's brilliant. But I also want to say that Silva got a yellow card right at the end. He was losing his shit so much he got yellow carded. I thought manager just got sent off, but he got a yellow card somehow. Right. So four more and he gets a match ban, I assume.
Pretty funny. But anyway, that's probably enough for us tonight. So let's call it and we'll man end the match. On our man of the match. So, Lee, you first.
Wilson. Although Wilson. I will say that Longstaff had a good shift. Willock had a great shift. But I think just because Wilson is still not up to top speed, but he got into so many really, really promising positions, some lovely touches, some lovely turns to lose his man. Didn't have quite the finesse at the end, but that, I mean, if that's the start of the process, then he's well on his way to banging them in again for us. And take us to the end of the season. So I think just because of where he's come from, where he is right now, and what he did, and he's got an assist, don't forget, Wilson for me.
Cool. Craig, you?
Mitro's left foot. I think that gets mad at the match for the assist that he got on that one. That was absolutely superb. Now, I think Big Joe, given the circumstances of what's happened over the past few days or so, it could have really affected him mentally. But he knuckled down and he put in a typical Big Joe shift, if you like, to the point where we almost expect it now, week in, week out. He was absolutely fantastic in whether he was out on the wing or down the middle to replace Bruno. He was absolutely superb. But a big draw for me, but a very, very close shout to where Sean Longstaff, that cross at the end when he could have been absolutely knackered and fatigued. I think he ran 9.8K that game, which again is higher than anybody else. Was absolutely superb. I've gone. But it was absolutely superb. Big Joe for me, but Longstaff was very, very close.
Awesome. For me, I see the benefit of going. I see the justification for going for Wilson. I'm going to go for Miggy just because he did so much off the ball in this game that kind of went unnoticed a little bit because he wasn't involved in all of the attacks that he normally is. But he did have some really good runs. He had some very good passages of play where he closed things down. He was passing the ball around well with the midfield. Had a couple of nice little link-ups with Bruno before Bruno went off as well. And, you know, Trippier had probably one of his worst games for us, I think, in terms of his delivery and his overall passing. Still not having a go at Trippier by any stretch of the imagination, but he was definitely down on his normal form. And I think for Miggy to still be involved in the game as much as he was without that assistance from Trippier that he would normally be getting, kind of shows the value that he has to that side at the moment. And I think he kind of deserves a little bit of credit for that.
I just want to say, is Miggy getting faster with each game?
I don't know where he gets the energy from.
He just never stops. But he's getting faster with each game. I'm bloody sure of it, mate. He was fast, isn't he, man? Honestly,
he scoffs a bag of Haribo Tang Fastics before every game because that lad is either chewing Duracell batteries or he's eating shitloads of sugar beforehand because he's lightning on legs. He really is.
We keep getting on that he keeps getting substituted, but he covers so much ground at so much pace. I mean, he might not cover the same amount of ground as Longstaff because he's probably not on the pitch for as long, but the pace that he does it with and the amount that he closes people down is just, yeah, the kid's got energy for days. He's like a bloody Energizer bunny. So we'll call it up there. It's been good. Always like the win podcasts. Everyone's enjoyed listening to us rant on, despite the VAR sort of episode midway. So thank you for listening. Thank you for watching on YouTube. If you liked us, hit the subscribe button, drop us a like, and send us some comments in for the Thursday night live show. So we'll be doing a live podcast on Thursday night. Our time, so 10 o'clock in the morning,
10 a.m. morning, lunch, yep.
10 a.m.
Every Thursday.
So drop us your questions, drop us your comments, and we'll try to cover as many as we can. But if you can hop online and ask them live, that would be even better. So thanks very much, everyone. Thanks for Craig and Lee for their time tonight. Excuse my slight little technical glitches here and there. I will go and sort my internet out before the next one. We'll catch up with you guys later. Cheers, guys.
Cheers, Mark. How are the tune?
Come on. Third spot.
Get in.